Okay, happy last week of instruction, students. Today we're going to cover turning your pitch or your treatment or your idea into a screenplay. I'm going to talk you guys through some of the things you think about when we start to write our screenplays, and also technically how to write and how to format your scripts using two very strong tools or software packages. One is Microsoft Word, and the other is Screenplay Formatter, which is part of your Google Drive. It's an app within Google Drive that does a really great job of formatting screenplays. So what do we have to do? Well, some of you turned in pitches that were very specific and visual and articulate, and were already a ways away towards being a finished or completed screenplay. And some of you presented more of an idea or a couple of ideas that you wanted to bring together into your screenplay. So wherever you are in your process with your story, you have to focus first on what it is that's most important to you, what it is that you really want to get across to your audience, and then think about what steps you're going to take to get there. For instance, if you want the audience to hope, remember we talked earlier about hope and fear, and the importance of manipulating hope and fear as key emotions in writing a story. If you want to manipulate your audience's hope and fear that your character is going to do the right thing, well, typically you might show them off saying that they're not going to, as with the character of Han Solo in Star Wars. Originally, he positions himself as being in it for the money. He'll save the princess, but for money. And the audience wonders, well, is he really just in it for the money, or does he have human feelings, and can Luke and the team, you know, persuade him to help them with whatever they need? And then by the end of the film, our hope is rewarded when it turns out that between two chances of abandoning his friends to fight the Death Star and joining in with them to fight the Death Star, at the end he chooses to join with them and lend his capabilities to help them. So that's all storytelling is. You are going to take what you want to communicate, what you want your audience to think about, and you're going to break it up into individual scenes. And as I said, some of you have already done this. So the trick with a short screenplay is that you've typically only got 5 to 10 minutes or 1 to 3 scenes in which to show the whole arc, from who your character is when we meet them, to show what happens to them, how they respond to it, how that action and interaction with other characters causes them to grow and adapt and learn and change, and then how they respond during the final threat, which we know is called the climactic scene. So, and then the resolution result after the climax. No matter if you're talking about a 2-hour film or a 7-minute short film, all of them have these key story beats: the setup, the dramatic conflict, and the climax and resolution. So you've got your idea, and you may have to decide, what scenes do I need to explore this idea? And then who does my main character have to meet of all the different types of characters that we talked about? Mentor, antagonist, love interest, allies, victims. What sorts of characters do you need to populate your story with? Again, because your story is a short script, probably there will only be 2 or 3 characters in most situations. If you need more than that, you should think about it, because it's challenging to write that, and it's also challenging if it comes time to film it. So typically writers break down their scripts into individual scenes. They decide which characters are needed for which scenes, and then they write out the action moment by moment, including in their script everything that is visual, everything that the audience needs to see and specifically what they need to see. Because film, again, is unlike theater in this way. You as the filmmaker choose what the audience is going to see at every single moment. And that's why you can even write into your script what shots you're going to use to tell the story. Although I recommend writers only do that when it's necessary, because otherwise the decision of what shots to use is typically the job of the director, as we've talked about. But if you need to understand that, you know, we're seeing a knife in the hand and a gloved hand, and that's necessary for the story to proceed, then it comes under the responsibility of the writer to make sure that that is the way it is written into the script. Okay, with this in mind, we are going to talk about the four different types of a screenplay now. And this actually is associated with the pages from your textbook that you have read today, where we break down the four different types of items, four different parts of a screenplay. Okay, the first part of the screenplay is called the slug line. The slug line is a capitalized heading that goes before each and every scene that tells the audience whether the scene is happening inside or outside, where the scene is taking place, and what time of day, or whether it's day or night. And this is typically written for interior, which is abbreviated INT, period, for interior scenes. Exterior, which is EXT for exterior scenes. So your scene might start off with a header that says interior church dash day or exterior Jamie's garden dash night. But every scene should start off with a slug line. And that's one of the most unusual things that students have to get used to doing. Every time you change the scene, you need a new slug line. That's what tells the reader, and that's what also tells the crew that we're starting a new scene, is the new slug line. It's capitalized. We put a space or a line before and after every slug line, and it just makes the script easy to read. It also lets the producer add up the amount of pages that are shot interior at a location and exterior at a location, and try to determine how many days the crew is going to need to shoot one particular place. The second part of a screenplay is the scene description. The scene description is all of the action that takes place in the course of your movie. It's everything that the audience sees on screen or hears on screen, written out one piece at a time. So if the first thing we're going to see is a lonely road and then a dog runs down the street until we can't see them anymore, you write that. If the camera is following a bouncing ball as it bounces into a pool, you write that. If a man walks into a store, looks at a stand with sunglasses and takes a pair of sunglasses and slips it into his pocket, that's exactly what you write. You write exactly what we hear and exactly what we see. And the challenge is to describe everything using just the right words so that the audience gets the exact feeling on the page that you want them to get when they watch the movie. Scene description is always written in the present tense. So you might write, Andy and Jamie walk into Andy's room, grab Andy's book bag, and exit quickly. It's always present tense, unlike novels or short stories that are typically written in the past tense. Screenplays are written in the present tense because everything is happening immediately. When you read it, it should be just like you're seeing it. And the other rule of screenplays is that everything you write should be something that can be seen. So if you want to talk about a character who is lonely or afraid or patriotic or misses their dad or anything, you have to decide what it is on the page that's going to communicate that to your audience. Make sure that there's something, some symbol or some image, something that represents your idea. What thing represents the idea of love, of courage, of friendship? that's the job of the filmmaker, the job of the screenwriters, to come up with ways to communicate these sometimes complicated ideas. Using those rules, screenplays are actually not that difficult to write. The trick, as I said before, is coming up with just the right word to communicate the specific thing or description of a thing that you want to get across. And sometimes that takes a little while to do, to come up with just the right word. There is one technical aspect to the writing, which is that there are five things that I'm going to tell you right now that are actually capitalized. When you put them in your screenplay, they are capitalized in a way that is different than the way they would be written into a short story or a novel. And these five things are: one, the name of a character the first time we meet them. So if I'm a character in a movie, the first time I actually appear on screen, Mr. McCluskey walks into the classroom and stands ready to give the lecture, you would capitalize my character's name, Mr. McCluskey. But every other time that I appear in the movie later on, you would not necessarily capitalize it. I've seen a few writers who capitalize names every single time somebody appears in their script, but that's uncommon. Okay, the second thing that is capitalized is sound effects. A gunshot blasts, a window shatters, a horn honks, and those sound effects tend to be capitalized. And the reason is there's an individual team of sound designers and sound effects people who have to go and make that effect or edit it or cut it or mix it in to the overall audio track. And they want to keep track of where all those sound effects are. So when it's capitalized, it helps it stand out on the page a little bit. And that brings us to our next item, and that is visual effects. So if you have like a white aura or a white halo around one of your characters for some mystical effect or time travel, or characters disappear or reappear or shoot an energy beam from their hands or something of that nature, something that has to be created by the visual effects team, that would typically be capitalized. Another thing that is capitalized is movements of camera. If you want to move the camera during a shot or in the middle of a shot or the middle of a scene, that movement would typically be capitalized. Like if you want to write, the camera pushes in on her mother's face as her mother gets the terrible news, or the camera whips over to reveal Pedro as he looks at his test results or something of that nature, that movement of camera would typically be capitalized. And the last thing that would be capitalized are shots, individual shots, like a close-up or a medium shot, are capitalized. And some writers even give these shots their own line in the script, like a slug line. Some writers do it, some writers don't. You can do it if you want to. So it could be like extreme close-up, Janet's eyes would be its own capitalized line in your script. Oh yes, one last thing that is capitalized in your script are props. Important things that have to be purchased or built or designed or made for your movie, whether they are guns or books or devices or something a character carries around with them. Anything that's not furniture is probably considered a prop, smaller items. And those are capitalized because just like sound effects and visual effects, they have to be gotten, they have to be purchased, they have to be made, they have to be built, they have to be accounted for. And so we capitalize them so that they will stand out to the crew as well. Okay, so at this point we've covered slug lines, we've covered scene description, and the third thing we have to cover is transitions. So the scene description, which is, again, one way I think of it is it's a list of all the images and sounds in your scene, and that can include virtually anything. Eventually the scene will end and we will go on to the next scene. And the transition is what tells us how we go from the scene we're in to the next scene. The most typical transitions, which are all listed in your book, are cut to. Cut to is the most popular transition by far. Cut to is where one shot ends and another shot simply begins, and they don't overlap at all. And that transition is by far the most popular transition, and it covers more than 92% of all transitions are cuts. The second most popular transition is the dissolve. A dissolve is a transition where you've got an image up on screen, and then that image slowly seems to become another image from somewhere else. It can suggest a passage of time or an extraordinary change of place, like if somebody's going on a trip, or you know, any number of things. It creates a kind of a mysterious or a moody feeling that is different than a cut. And we'll look at some examples in class just to make sure you know what it is and how to use it. The third type of transition to know about is called a wipe. A wipe is another way to go from scene to scene. It's kind of an alternative to a dissolve. In a wipe, it's actually, some people call it a wipe dissolve. A wipe is when one image kind of like just pushes the other image off the screen, up or down. Sometimes there's like an iris, which is a circle opens up or closes on the screen. And these are pretty uncommon transitions to see nowadays. They used to be very popular in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. These days, you'll only see them very rarely. Filmmakers use them. The Star Wars franchise and George Lucas famously used a lot of irises and kind of old time, old fashioned wipes in their movies. But you don't see it that often. The last transition, which is probably used the least frequently, is the fade in and the fade out. The fade in, which could also be called a fade from black, is usually at the beginning of a movie. And you might notice with a movie or TV show, frequently the screen is black at the beginning. Like you'll see the titles or you'll see the logos with the names of the companies that worked on the movie. And then the screen will go black for a few seconds. And then suddenly the first image will fade in. And that's why they call it a fade in. The image fades in from black and the screen goes from black to the first image of the movie. And it's very much like you're going into the movie. You're going into the world of the movie. If the movie is like a dream, you're about to sit down and have like a 2-hour long dream, you know? And the fade in is like you're going into the dream now. You're like leaving the world behind and you're going into the dream of the movie. At the end of the movie, just the same way, like closing an equation, you typically have a fade out. You came into the movie and now you're going to have a slow fade out at the end, and then they're going to run the credits and the movie is over. You're out of the story and the movie has gently deposited you back in your chair. The dream is over, the story is over, and you go back to your life. Do you have to have a fade in and a fade out? No, you don't. You can cut into the beginning of a movie. If you cut into the beginning of a movie, it's like a pop. You'll go into the movie with some different energy. You'll pop right into the beginning. I think Quentin Tarantino's directorial debut, Reservoir Dogs, if I remember correctly, they pop right into the first shot. And some movies will just, if they have a surprise or a shock or a funny ending, sometimes movies will just pop off at the end. They'll cut to black instead of fading to black. Can you do it? Sure. When would you do it? I don't know. Think about it. You know, maybe it'll feel right for you when you're writing your movie to do cuts instead of dissolves. Two things I want to tell you about your transitions. Number one, some of the ways that screenplays were designed were to make them easier to read. Like you look at a screenplay and you'll see a slug line, skip a line, do your scene description, skip to your next portion of scene description, skip a line, dialogue, skip a line, dialogue, skip a line, transition. So this all makes a screenplay very easy to read because you always know what kind of thing you're reading. Sometimes in novels, it's a little complicated. But in screenplays, you pretty much always know what kind of thing you're reading. And it's easy for actors and the crew to know what they're doing because screenplays are just really easy to read. Slug lines and scene description line up on the left side, the left margin of the page, which is typically 1 inch from the edge of the page. Transitions, with one exception, transitions line up, I think, 6 inches from the left side of the page. So the easiest way to talk about it is to say they actually line up on the right side of the page. They line up an inch away from the right side of the page. So all your transitions that you'll see, cut to, dissolve to, wipe to, all of those will be on the right side of the page, as I said, with one exception. Fade in goes on the left side of the page. Fade in goes on the left, fade out goes on the right, cut two goes on the right, dissolve two goes on the right, wipe two goes on the right. Only fade in goes on the left. The last thing you need to know about transitions is that the cut is the most popular transition, and you don't need to write cut to into your script if you're using a cut. If you just leave the transition blank, a cut will be assumed. So you can not write cut, and then you can just leave it blank, and we'll assume it's a cut unless you want to do a dissolve or a wipe or something else of that kind. Every scene should have a transition after it. But as I say, if you're planning a cut, you don't have to write cut. Some writers do, some writers don't. But every scene will have some kind of a transition after it, just like every shot basically has a transition, and it's usually the cut. And that brings us up to our last part of a screenplay, which is a dialogue. Dialogue refers broadly to any kind of communication that happens in a script. So the main default type of dialogue is dialogue between two or more characters, where characters are speaking to each other on camera or off camera. Sometimes you hear a character speaking from off camera, and that dialogue has to be accounted for also. It has to be recorded and mixed and added into the film. But there are a couple of other types of dialogue or communication that also are part of a film. The first is voiceover. Voiceover is when we hear a character talking about something, but we don't see them. There's a disconnect between the voice and the image. The character might be talking about a bank robbery that they're going to design or pull off, and then we see different shots of the bank or the street around the bank on that day. So there's a disconnect between what is being shown and what is being heard. That recording is called a voiceover. There's also narration. In narration, we hear a voice representing the voice of the author. Sometimes we also say that the voice is an omniscient narrator who is like a God or some all-knowing being who just tells us the story but is not involved in the story in any way. The narrator can also be a character from the story, which is typically called a third-person narrator who is telling us the story that he or she themselves were actually a part of. So we've got voiceover, which is somebody in the story telling us something else that's happening related to the story. We have narration, where somebody is telling us the story as if it happened in the past. We have dialogue, which is between a couple of characters. And the final type of communication in a film or TV show is the interior monologue. This is an interesting one because this is one where we see a character on screen, we hear their voice, but what we are hearing is not the actual voice of the character, but rather is their thoughts. And a lot of times sound engineers and mixers and sound effects people and post-production audio specialists will change the processing on the voices to make them sound a little bit different, as if they are echoing inside somebody's head or inside their mind. Of the four of those, the only one that requires synchronization between the image of the character who's speaking and what they're saying is dialogue. Dialogue represents over 90% of what we hear in a film in terms of communication between the characters. So when there's dialogue, there's always the issue of synchronization. Dialogue that is recorded with the picture is automatically synchronized as long as they're both recorded at the same rate of speed, like 30 frames per second or 60 frames per second, will automatically sync up perfectly well. Other types of communication do not have to be synchronized, although they do have to be generally synchronized to the image. They do not have to be frame synchronized the way that the dialogue is. So there we have it. Those are the four different parts of a screenplay: the slug line, the scene description, the transitions, and the dialogue. The last thing I want to mention about dialogue is that sometimes the writer wants to indicate how a line is being said, especially if the words on the page don't indicate that the actor will necessarily know to say the line the right way. So if I am playing a character in a show and I'm talking to another character and I'm supposed to be saying something sarcastic to them, and the line just says, how could I be angry with you? But I'm supposed to say it sarcastically. The writer will typically write in parentheses right under the character name, which is going to be centered and capitalized right under the character name. In parentheses, it will say sarcastically. And then underneath it, you will find the dialogue itself. So the name of the character is capitalized and centered. The name of the words that are in parentheses are in parentheses and centered right beneath the name of the character, no skipping lines. And then the dialogue itself goes one line underneath that, no skipping. And that is going to be indented 1.5 more inches from the left and right margins of the text. So 1.5 inches in on the left, 1.5 inches in on the right. So that's a total of 3 inches plus 1 inch for each margin, left margin and right margin to the edge of the page. So 3 inches plus 2 inches is 5 inches. And then the column of text itself is going to be 3 inches across. That's why when you see a script, you'll notice that you can immediately tell what is the dialogue or some kind of communication, because it only goes 3 inches wide across the page. Everything else, the slug lines, the scene descriptions, go all the way across the page. So there are the 4 different types of items that you have in a screenplay: slug lines, scene description, transitions, and dialogue. Those 4 things, everything that you want to write for your screenplay will fall into one of those 4 categories. So now we're going to jump into, how do we use the 2 different softwares that I mentioned earlier at the top of this lesson to actually write the screenplay?
Good afternoon. In this session, we are going to practice using Google Screenplay Formatter to format your screenplay. So let's just jump right into it. I'm going to share my screen. I'm going to make sure that you can see it as well as possible. And now I will share right here. Okay, so here we are in Google Docs, an untitled document. I can even go back one. When you go into Google Docs, it'll look like this. So you basically want to start with a new document, click plus, come in here. Now, if you haven't added Screenplay Formatter yet, you're going to have to go up to add-ons and get an add-on and find and choose Screenplay Formatter. I've already done that, so all I have to do is launch it, but I'm not going to launch it just yet, because at the beginning of your script, you're going to want to have a couple of pieces of information that don't need to be formatted like a screenplay, and it's just easier if you do them first. So if I have my script, let's say I'm calling my script The Rescue, and the script is by me, say I'm in period 7, and today's date is the 8th, 7th, okay, 7th. So here's my startup information. If I hit Command A, I grab all of that. Now what do I want to do? Do I want it in the left, in the center, or the middle? I want it in the center. So I just click the center align, and it goes there. Also, as you heard in the previous lesson, or you read in your notebook, all screenplays are 12 point. Here it says 11. I'm going to kick it up to 12. And they're not in Arial font. They are in Courier New. So I'm going to find Courier New. And now I'm basically good to go. Except, you know, this is fine. It's just a little bit small for me. So I'm going to kick it up to 125 in the view, maybe even 150, so it's easy to see and it's easy for you guys to see. Okay, so now I've got that key information and I'm actually ready to start writing the script itself. So now I want to go over to add-ons, go to Screenplay Formatter and launch. So you see a window over here, which is my Screenplay Formatter, and it's got all the main things that I want to do are listed here. So let's just go through and we'll write a bit of a scene ourselves to familiarize ourselves with how easy it is to use this. And it is very easy. Okay. First question, what are the two words that start over 90% of all the scripts that we read or probably will write? What is the first transition that brings us from the blackness of before the movie starts into the first shot? That is correct. They are fade in. So all I have to do is go down here to the transition section. You see this is a section for text formatting, special formatting, transition. So here we go. Fade in. Now you notice that it typed it in automatically, fade in, capitalized, and put it over on the left side. This is called left justified. And that's the way it should look. So fade in looks correct here. So now I just hit return, return. Remember, every time we go from a transition to a slug line or a slug line to a scene description or to dialogue, we skip a line when we go from one thing to any other type of thing. So now we are in our scene. So we just start typing a sheep. No, that's a mistake, guys. Remember, before we start typing in the scene, we have to put in what? That's right, we need a slug line. Now, I love Screenplay Format Adapter, Screenplay Adapter. And one of the only things I don't really like about it is that what it describes over here are not the exact definitions that are used in the industry, but it's easy enough to fix. They call it a header. So I'm gonna click header. New scene header, but look what it is. It's a slug line. So I'm just gonna write, now notice I'm not even gonna capitalize it when I type it in. This is one of the things they do to make it easier for you. You don't have to capitalize it. EXT, period, tab, space, space, sheep, farm, dash, day. Create header, and there it is. Firm, no, farm, sorry. Okay, it turned my lowercase to uppercase. It left justified it, and I'm good to go. So there's my slug line for my first scene. Now I return, and now what we call scene description, they call action, which is everything that's in the movie. They call it action. We and the industry refer to it occasionally as action. What is the action of the scene? But mostly we call it scene description. So here it is. They give you an option to type in a new character name. So sure, I'll do it their way. They will have a list of the characters based on this. I could have just capitalized it because we know that when we meet a character for the first time, we capitalize it. A lone sheep named Shirley. Nope, that started. She strayed. Strayed. I'm going to another shot now, and to represent that, I'm skipping to another paragraph. Suddenly a massive spaceship rises up behind her. And its winds knock Shirley on her butt. And notice the second time I use the word Shirley to represent that character, I don't capitalize it because the name of a character is typically capitalized just the first time that we see them on screen, which is here. Likewise, other things including visual effects and sound effects and props and camera moves. Would be capitalized as well. Like if I wrote here, push in on the spaceship as we see the face of Zoltar, the alien commander, staring through the spaceship window at Earth. Okay, so we've got three paragraphs here. It's all action, and it sort of represents three different shots or three different story beats. Like every time something new happens, some new information happens, we get some new, we get a new paragraph in essence, okay? So now we're gonna go to dialogue, something that Zoltar says, right? So I'm gonna return, go to the next thing here. So for dialogue, there's a specific way to format this. And the first thing you want to do is click speaker, the speaker. And you say who your speaker is, and your speaker in this case is Zoltar. Create speaker. And there you go, Zoltar, his name is there. In the book, I tell you to center the names of speakers. And this is not technically centered, it's like three tabs in. We also covered in the book the parenthetical, which is if you want to tell the audience or the reader how a line of dialogue should be said, I recommend students to use parentheticals, notes in parentheses sparingly, but let's do one right now just to give you an example of it. Parentheses. After you put in your parentheses, your parenthetical comment, give an extra space in there. No, I don't. Okay. Then you go to the next line, and then you click dialogue, which is actually what the character is going to say. And then I'm just going to paste in what I wrote there. Okay. So here is the dialogue. Look at them with their soft white coverings. These earth creatures will be no match for the Zoltarians. And now we go back to action. And we are ready to go on to the next shot. But you can also use the scene description to make comments on what you have put up on the screen occasionally. This is a little bit cheeky, and I don't recommend doing it that much. But in this case, because there's sort of like a specific comedy element here, I think it would be okay to write something like, wait a minute, does he think that sheep rule the earth? And now we are going to create a transition to the next scene. Let's say this is the end of scene one, and we're moving on to scene two. So just like we had a transition going in, which was fade in. Now we could have the transition here cut to, but you'll notice this, if I put in a cut to right here, look what happens. It puts it over on the right side, because as we said in the book and in the last lesson, all transitions go on the right side. This is called right justified, except for fade in. Fade in goes on the left side, and all the other transitions go on the right side. So there you are. We have a full scene here. Fade in, which is an opening transition. We have the slug line, which they refer to as header. We have some scene description, which is every single visual or audio element that we want the audience to see in order for them to understand the story. We have dialogue, which is the name of the speaker, the parenthetical remark, and the actual dialogue itself. And then we have a final transition out. Now remember, if we transition out like with a cut to, we don't actually have to put cut to there. we could just start the next scene, which would be the next slug line. So I could just go to here and go to header. This is a new scene. Interior. Jim Davis's office. A. Who is Jim Davis? I don't know. Probably we'll meet him this scene. Okay. So if I don't put cut to, the cut to is still assumed. Okay. I hope you guys found that helpful. You should be able to use all of those steps that we just went over to help you write a fantastic screenplay. And look, it just took us about 5 or 6 minutes to write one scene. So it may take you a little bit longer, but it shouldn't take you that much longer. So good luck with that. And when we come back, I'm going to show you how to do the same thing in Microsoft Word.